his name. I didn't know it at the time. Jesse.
Is it Jesse Rosenfeld?
Jesse Rosenfeld.
Well, we know him because he's done some work for us from the Middle East.
Okay. He's reporting apparently for The Guardian. He doesn't have a G20 ID badge. He has the Guardian ID badge. So the police officers say to him, one grabs him by one arm, the other grabs him by the other arm, picks him up, drags him over, says, we're going to take your badge, we're going to check and see if you are who you say you are, and wait right here. He had no choice to wait right there. They were holding on to him. Jesse wasn't rude and he wasn't belligerent, but he continued to press them. Why are you detaining me? Why won't you let me do my job? I'm here from The Guardian. It's a reputable newspaper. Why, you know, why? He kept going like this. And they took the badge. One officer left, presumably to do the identity check. He continued to push the officers by asking them, why am I here? What are you doing? Why won't you let me do my job? He was completely immobilized. Jesse's like 5'5", 140 pounds. I mean, he's a scrawny little guy. A third police officer wearing T-shirts and shorts, not riot gear, walked over and just hauled back and gave him one right in the gut. And Jesse doubled over.
This is while he's being held by other policemen.
Jesse fell down face first onto the ground. Same officer then came, elbowed him right on the back. And he's obviously out of commission at that point, and I think screaming as well. The officer who was escorting me away at this point, I mean, we both saw it, looked at me and said, geez, that shouldn't have happened. Shouldn't have done that. And then I was kind of rushed away.
And at this point, we were definitely cornered, and it had been a while. Presumably, people would have left if the police had let us leave, but we were totally sealed off, and there was absolutely nowhere to go. And on a couple of occasions, they told us, leave, go home, which was very, very hypocritical because, yeah, we had absolutely nowhere to go. A lot of people, probably a lot more than half, collapsed into the entrance of the parking garage of the Novotel. And a group of us, maybe about 50, stayed in the middle. Still maybe a couple of chants going on. And at that point, they just started snatching people and disappearing them behind the police lines.
Frankly, I don't know why it had to happen. I think there's a distinction that needs to be made between people who only want to destroy property and torch police cars and are wearing disguises so you can't make out their identity, and they have a kind of orchestrated, strategic approach to, you know, damaging property and harming people. There's that. And then there was what I saw, which was middle-class people of all ages, a very diverse crowd, just trying to make a point that whether the G20 is here or whether it isn't here, we don't necessarily give up all of our civil rights to speak freely and to assemble. That's the only point, as far as I could tell, and I talked to probably 50 demonstrators over the course of the night, that's the only point they were trying to make. And for trying to make that point, several hundred of them ended up in jail, and a few of them got beaten up.
Where were you taken?
I was drove in a minute and a half in a dark paddy wagon to a prisoner bus, which then was taken to the Eastern Avenue Detention Center.
What time did you get there eventually?
I guess I got there maybe around 1:30.
In the morning?
Yeah.
And what time were you released?
I was released maybe at around 10 o'clock the next night. I was held for 24 hours in handcuffs the whole time.
Oh, the next night?
Oh, yeah, the next night. I was held for just before the 24 hours you can legally hold somebody.
Were you fed, given water?
I was held in handcuffs about 8 hours. I was put into a cage that was 10 by 20 with 40 guys. You may have heard them say, these are meant for 10 guys. We understand sometimes there was upwards of 20. I was in there with 40 guys and one 16-year-old kid. They had a 16-year-old kid in there with 39 men for 24 hours. About 8 hours in, we had to start begging for water. We had to, you could hear all the other cages yelling for water.
This
we had to start a water.
Very hot day, wasn't it?
Yeah, we had to start a water riot. A lot of these, like I'd been in custody since 10:30, and now it was almost. We were fed about 12 hours in, but again, you had to riot for that as well.
You got these. Riot. What do you mean?
You had to start shaking the cages. Everyone was yelling, water, water. They'd either laugh at you or say they were working on it.
Well, they claim it was very difficult logistically to get water to so many people.
Oh, really? Because when we came in, there was skids upon skids of water bottles, and what we got was a jug of blue water on an office rolly chair with Dixie cups, where they would do a little squirt and hand it out to each prisoner, when there was just skids upon skids of Gatorade and water. Never got an apple or orange. I know that was in the footage. It was freezing cold in there. It was kind of unbelievable. The officer who dropped off the last guy, the 40th guy, said, "How many guys are in here?" And we're like, "There's 40 guys in here." And they're like, "What do they think this is, Auschwitz?"
Anyway, so to proceed now with, I guess, the time spent in the first cell, me and most of the group, but like about another like 7 or 8 of us, stayed in that cell for 12 hours. Of course, like as the repeated stories, none of us got phone calls, none of us got contact to legal aid despite asking for it several times. Conditions-wise, it was very psychologically confusing, I guess. Like the floor is very cold, concrete floor is very cold in the room itself. The bright lights were constantly on. We had no idea where what time it was. So it was a very strange atmosphere. We got water after a few hours, but very small portion. Again, like despite asking several times. And food, again, was very scarce, and we had to ask for it several times.
The only thing we really got was like a little Dixie cup of water twice a day, and it was like lukewarm. We also got sugar-free, like, little same thing of lukewarm Tang, and we would get 2 sandwiches a day with just a piece of cheese on it. That's all we got every day. And the lights were on 24 hours, so nobody really got any sleep. The first pen that we were in has an outhouse with no door, and there's 40 people in this little room when there's only supposed to be a maximum of 15.
These cells would have one bench. I know mine was sort of standing room only. You had to take turns if you wanted to sit. In her cell, all the porta potties in there had the doors taken off. And so if a woman had to go to the washroom, all the male officers could watch. So what they would have to do is...
But did they watch?
Yes. So what they did is they formed something called... They would call out wall, and all the women would form a human wall. And because everyone was still handcuffed, they had to help wipe each other. And I eventually, from begging for water, passed out in my cell. I fell over. I don't really know too much what happened. They refused to come in and get me. My cellmates had to drag me to the door. I was apparently given some watered down juice and put back on a bench. And that's when I remember having the ringing headache. The guard that gave me the juice, my fiance told me, came over to their cage and broke down and started crying, saying, "I don't know why you guys are in here. This is wrong." And we had similar incidences with 2 officers at ours as well.
So we assumed that we were being released, but they just in fact brought us to another cell. So again, like a very hard time to get food again in that cell and water. No information whatsoever, basically the same thing. We had a mate in our cell who's diabetic. And on 2 occasions, he wasn't doing well, like his blood sugar was low. They took him out and brought him into the infirmary and gave him a couple of insulin shots, I assume, but always brought him back to the cell. And every time they brought him back, within an hour, he was feeling sick. He wasn't feeling well again. And it got to a point where he was feeling so bad that we were trying to get him water and he was shaking. And he was like, clearly he was losing color. He was not doing well at all. And we were obviously calling for attention, yelling out at them at this point for quite a while, half an hour, 40 minutes, until he finally collapsed off the bench. At that point, finally they got people and brought him out. And we were yelling at them to actually bring him to the hospital to hospitalize him and not just to get him and throw him back in the cell again. And that's what they did. They took him out for about 10, 15 minutes and threw him back in the cell again.
I was inside for about 26 hours, I guess. At the 24th hour, I demanded that I to be released because that was my rights. And they assured me that my rights didn't apply in that building. And
why? What did they justify?
That's just all they said. They're like, "Sometimes your rights just don't apply here." So I'm like, "Oh, I'm pretty sure they apply everywhere, but if that's what you want to think." So after I was released, they were describing how we would have to go into like a holding cell, and then I mentioned my boyfriend, and he said, "Oh, you are a part of the gay community, are you not?" I'm like, "Yes," and he's like, "Well, the people in here don't really take too kind to your type, so I recommend you act straight during your visit here, and once you leave, you can act the way you choose." And then just kept going on. He's like, "Actually, I'm gonna put you and your boyfriend in a segregated room." And it was just a little stall, like it looked like a dog pen, and there was a whole line of just gay people in these like one person things. There was like a lesbian couple, there was me and my boyfriend, and then there was two separate lesbians that were just put there just because they were gay, but they didn't admit that, but they were put there for their own safety. Like, the entire group was not homophobic whatsoever. The only people who were homophobic in that building were the police.
It's just absolutely unbelievable. Like, and obviously, when either some officers on the inside are starting to become sort of a little bit more sadistic or sort of enjoying that controller role, and others are breaking down and going into the I'm just following orders, I'm just a pea in a pod, something is wrong. Like, I'm not anti-protester, I'm not anti-police, I'm pro-truth. One of the things they said, I think Bill Blair said it, is that everyone was recorded from the moment they stepped into that place to the moment they stepped out. And we actually had to read a sign as we were coming in saying, all audio and video of you will be recorded. And there was a camera right above watching us the whole time.
Well, that's standard though, isn't it?
Yeah, that's...
For your own protection.
Yeah,
well.
Exactly. And my position right now is release the detention center footage. Released the closed-circuit television footage from the streets.
Why would they have to do that?
Why would they have to do that? Well, because what there's the statements that they said was that we understand these cages are built for 10 people. We understand sometimes they're upwards of 20. They were fed regularly. They were watered regularly. Why not? I wasn't. I was in a cage with 40 guys. I passed out and was denied medical attention. I want people to hear the recording of that Toronto Police Service's officer saying, what do they think this is? Auschwitz. Mm. And then I want people to say that an inquiry is not required. So whoever was in charge, whoever was calling the shots, failed all those officers and failed all the citizens involved.
Again, those watching, and I know there'll be people watching now who are saying, oh, yeah, it's all one-sided. Imagine if you're from a different political background, you were on a pro-life demonstration, or you were protesting against some left-wing measure, and the police treated you this way. Please don't get the idea that the police are particularly political. I think often the police can be, and they should be, quite robotic. It's the law, and they will enforce the law, and if they're told to go beyond that, they might go beyond that. I know many police officers, they've told me, think the whole thing was a disaster. They're ashamed, they think their reputation has been sullied. This is wrong. This is wrong.
I've always had a positive experience with the police, and suddenly this has completely changed my view on everything.
Benjamin Yao was walking to work. He's a TTC collector and was in his uniform. He says there were no protesters in sight, but police were blocking an intersection, so he started walking the other way.
They basically just knocked me down, and another one came and held me down, and they started handcuffing me.
When I was being arrested, I mean, they wanted to know if this was the tool that I was going to use on them.
What is this?
It's a transfer punch.
Benjamin was taken to the Eastern Avenue Detention Center and told he would be charged with resisting arrest and breach of peace.
It was sheer terror. I've never experienced anything like it. I had 4 cups of water in 36 hours. I was crying, but I had no tears. I was so dehydrated. This was a form of martial law, as far as I'm concerned.
Our cameras interviewed Benjamin moments after he was released early Monday morning. He had been in custody since Saturday night and had been told all charges against him were dropped.
I can't believe this happened. Like, this, just absolutely shocked. I don't know what to say.
Leaders have made their stand, and outside the red security zone, police and protesters have made theirs. It has been another day Canada's biggest city won't soon forget. Smiles and friendly waves as nations back Canada's plan to bring global economies and deficits under control. But just a few blocks to the east, more ugliness on the streets. A confrontation outside the center where people are being detained. While downtown, store owners are cleaning up and counting their losses from yesterday's violence.
The people united will never be defeated. 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 The people united will never be defeated.
Of mine.
or seven officers charging towards me to arrest me. They basically, I didn't resist when they picked me up, threw me on the pavement once. I was able to put my right hand down to keep my face from hitting the pavement. Then I was picked up very violently and kind of dragged up. I was thrown down again. I had been basically snatched by uniformed officers. At that time, four men in plain clothes then took me, sort of threw me towards an unmarked van. If you can picture this, the middle seat of the van was actually folded down so that there was a space to lie on, essentially. I was thrown in and jostled around. I was put on my back so that my feet were towards the end of the van, and my head was towards the passenger seat and the driver's seat. And one of the officers, who I know to be Officer Kevin Antoine of the Division 52 in the Toronto Police, Kevin Antoine is badge number 7880. Officer Antoine then sat on top of me. Another man who I have no idea whether he's a police officer or not. No one ever identified themselves to me as a police officer. The second officer then, Officer Antoine was punching me in the torso after I was thrown in the van. The second officer then actually went and choked me and dug his thumb deeply into my carotid artery. And I almost went unconscious. Then Officer Antoine was just continuing to sit on top of me and sort of shifting around, sort of treating me like an inanimate object. My throat was held for about 10 seconds. I very closely tried not to lose consciousness at that point. At that point, I lost bladder control and urine seeped into my clothing. I did not go unconscious, and the other officer released my throat. At that point, that other officer then punched me in the head very hard. I still did not lose consciousness. At that point, Officer Antoine then sort of started patting around me and said, why is she wet? To the other officer, and the other officer replied that I had urinated on myself. And at that point, Officer Antoine then expressed disgust and scooted further down my legs. He had been sitting again over my pelvic area. At that point, Officer Antoine then continued to verbally assault me, was using a variety of very, very gender-specific terms, very sexually charged terms. They're terms that I do not want to repeat out loud. So Officer Antoine then continued to go ahead and verbally assault me as it took several minutes to pull into the police station. I had been flipped over on my stomach by that point, and he actually threatened to punch me in the nose as well and break my nose if I did not keep my face down towards the carpet. I was in a very vulnerable position, and I consider myself pretty lucky that things weren't actually worse. I stand with all of the women who have been assaulted and whose rights have been violated during the G20.
Go! That's what they shot at us.
All we are saying is give peace a chance.
Hello, this is Lacey MacAulay. I am here in Toronto, Canada, and I just wanted to happily report that yesterday I faced the charges in the Toronto court of assault of a police officer, which of course I did not do, and the case was very promptly withdrawn. Basically, the prosecutor said we have no interest in pursuing the charges. So, I'm a free woman, and that leaves me free to actually press charges against my attackers. So, thank you everyone for your wonderful support, and be well. Thank you.
One of the largely untold stories of the G20 are the events that took place in the community of Parkdale, just west of downtown Toronto. Parkdale played host to the Convergence Center, where those coming to protest the G20 could meet, eat food, and sleep. In the early afternoon of Sunday the 27th, the Toronto Community Mobilization Network held a press conference. This followed the previous afternoon's smashing of corporate storefronts, banks, and burning of police cars. But the conference organizers were there to talk about the police actions against people, which at that point had included a series of violent mass arrests, home raids of activists, accusations of illegal searches, and assaults. While the event wrapped up, word arrived that just a few blocks to the east, the police were surrounding the Convergence Center. When we arrived, they had sealed the area around the building and detained a small group. People from the community gathered around to see what was going on.
I have an opinion! Arrest me too!
Yeah! We have opinions! Arrest us!
Light bubbles. Cute!
I think it makes people smile.
My name is a mystery. No, I have nothing to hide.
If the bubble touches me, I'm going to be arrested for assault. Do you understand me?
Bubbles.
Yes, that's right. It's a deliberate act on your behalf. I'm going to arrest you. Do you understand me?
I understand.
Right, you're going to be in handcuffs. All right? You either knock it off with the bubble. If you touch me with that bubble, you're going into custody. Right?
I'm putting it away.
Right, thank you.
But I would also like to know...
You want to bait the police. So blow that on me or that other officer, and it gets in her eyes. It's a detergent. You'll be going into custody.
I understand.
Do we understand
that.
Each other?
I do. I would
and put it away.
I am doing that at this moment.
Right.
I really appreciate it.
Discussion's over.
If we could treat me with a bit of respect.
I just did.
Okay.
I just did.
I.
You got what you deserve. You got my respect. Right?
I don't feel very good. I'm just.
That's terrible.
Trying to
That's
keep you happy.
My heart bleeds.
Mine too.
Right?
I'm here.
Put it away.
I would,
right.
Yeah.
Knock it off.
Yeah.
For $1 billion, it could have got someone with a better attitude.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
She hasn't done anything, and you can talk to her in a very polite way.
I was
trying.
It's called professional.
Excuse me?
The incident gave rise to a popular series of parody animations on YouTube that depict Officer Bubbles in a series of situations arresting people at will for made-up infractions of non-existent laws, evidently intended to satirize the original bubble-blowing incident. Now, Officer Bubbles has launched a lawsuit against YouTube users to sue them for comments and videos because, according to his lawyer, the free speech of anonymous commenters on YouTube was inciting death threats and threats of violence against Officer Bubbles. The lawsuit also attempts to compel YouTube to reveal the actual personally identifying information of the users who are anonymous and have been identified in the lawsuit by their YouTube handles. One of the people named in the suit, a YouTube user known as Pussy McFats, but who has publicly revealed himself to be Todd Mara, a married father of two from Hamilton, Ontario, wrote a comment on one of the Officer Bubbles videos, quote, "Officer Bubbles probably looks at himself in the mirror a lot," end quote. It's unclear exactly how this could be perceived as inciting anyone to violence or how bringing a lawsuit against someone making such a comment disproves the observation in any way. In fact, Mara was quoted this week in the Toronto Star as saying, quote, "I'm a compassionate person. I don't think he should be ridiculed forever because of this. I was done with this in June. I left my comment and never thought about it again," end quote.
Somebody from the community who knows that I'm a lawyer said, "You're the lawyer, you've got to get down there, there's somebody who needs you." So I came, I immediately identified myself to one of the many police officers, and he came back to me after about 20 minutes and said that the person did not want to exercise his right to counsel, despite what I had heard from at least two other people.
Then police began to encircle the crowd and put some onlookers under arrest.
I knew that this was a situation very much in flux, so I stayed put where the police officer had told me to stand. I think that following their advice was the best thing to do in that circumstance. Turns out I was wrong.
That's when the lawyer who came to provide counsel to the detained was herself detained.
A large police officer grabbed me by the arm and shoved me into what later turned out to be the kettling area.
I'm just walking by and he started hitting me. He locked us in here.
The police started pulling people out, saying things like, "You, you've got a number on your arm. You're under arrest. You, you've got a bandana around your neck. You're under arrest. Backpack, under arrest.
What is this?
Obstruct.
Ouch.
Obstruct.
Ouch.
Obstruct.
Ouch.
He's good because
why are we obstructing?
Conspiracy to commit mischief.
Media, behind the line, please.
They were pulling people out at random, just giving those very simple yet clear yet illegal reasons. And I actually saw a police officer put a young girl, she must have been about 18 or 20 years old, into a chokehold. It picked her up so her legs were dangling off the ground, and while she was screaming, he said, "You're under arrest for having a number on your arm," and he pulled her away. The real irony is that we told people to do this so that they could have access to counsel, and it turned out that people were actually being arrested for having those numbers on their arms.
Over the next few hours, many community members gathered to denounce the police actions.
Where's your words? Where's your arrest warrant?
There's a lot of people being trapped by police who were trying to leave a situation. That's what I see. And that's kind of crazy. And they're arresting people who are doing absolutely nothing.
We don't want this in Parkdale. We don't want an occupation in Parkdale.
Parkdale,
we just like to know what's going on. It's our neighborhood.
For the entirety of the operation, neither the media, those detained, nor concerned community members were told what was going on.
To be there in the middle of my neighborhood, surrounded by a few hundred police officers, is something that I never thought would happen to me in my life. My father was a police officer. I've grown up with them. I don't even have the typical criminal defense lawyer mistrust of the police. If anything, I have to be careful not to give them the benefit of the doubt too often. But this is the first time in my life that I have been so afraid of the police.
Some people were told they were suspects in the previous day's broken windows and burnt police cars.
I was just getting on my bike to leave, and they said that somebody over there pointed at me and said that I was part of yesterday's fires. And then they went to go get him and apparently couldn't find him, and then said that I can go.
They eventually told the bulk group of us that we would be allowed to leave as long as we provided identification to the officers, and as long as we allowed searches of our bags. Huge breaches of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms that I could go on about for hours.
After arresting roughly 20 people, the police left the neighborhood. The Real News spoke to some of those who had been detained.
They thought we were passing a weapon. One of the police officers dragged me to the side. I turned around to face him, to talk to him, and he instead grabbed my other arm, spun me around, kicked me, kneed me in the ass, and then threw me on the ground and dragged me. Then he grabbed me and put me against a car. So a woman came up. She started searching me. She just lifted up my top in front of everybody, my bra and all. She didn't care who was looking. She didn't care if I was being exposed. She told me I was a baby. What these two cops did to me was like completely outrageous. Like
in my case, my real beef was the way I was treated, mostly. First of all, the fact that I was being detained without doing anything, without breaking any law. And secondly, because I was made fun of, that was the part that was also insulting, personally. They made fun of my nose. One of them told me I have a banana on my face. And another guy said that my nose is going to have a hard time handling what's going on. And I don't know if this was a reference to my, I don't know, hooked nose or something, but that's what happened.
It's a very small little community. So I think that when people were walking past, the shock of seeing the police officers in our little community was huge. And I think that's what really got people saying, get out of our neighborhood.
Ladies and gentlemen, Toronto is in police state lockdown. You are free to do as you are told. You are free to have your bag searched arbitrarily. You are free to hand in your identification. Please look up to your nearest CCTV camera so your face may be reported. You're all guilty until proven innocent. As long as you comply, show your identification, allow your property to be searched arbitrarily without a warrant, you will be safe. Obedience equals freedom. Slavery equals independence. Remember, you are not a unique and beautiful snowflake. You are a flesh and blood consumer. People are waking up philosophically, politically, and spiritually to the fact that we've been lied to every single day of our lives. This is a message which includes my message to the police. The people who control you are the same people who control us, and they do not care about us. And when the time is right for them, they will treat you with the same disrespect. They are using you guys. Thank you for being scared of terrorism for the last 10 years. We promise you the September 11th attacks were exactly as the corporate mainstream media told you. Do not do your own research. Doing your own research is very boring. Let the television and the newspapers do your research for you. We promise you the governments of this world have no reason to lie to you. I would like to apologize to the mainstream media cameramen here, because obviously with these messages you can't broadcast any of these things on the mainstream media, because your job isn't to educate the people as to what people here at the G20 actually think. It's to portray us as violent, dangerous people burning police cars. There are many Al-Qaeda terrorists here dressing in Toronto police uniforms. Please be very careful. These people may assault you. They may put metal brackets on your arms. They may even ask for your identification. Be very careful. Trust no one. Why are you blocking peaceful protesters off every 100 meters? Why are you not letting people walk freely in Toronto? If perhaps a member of the police public relations department would like to be interviewed by one of us, you can maybe explain to us why you're blocking us off like this.
At first, when we were starting to make our way down to Spadina, we were blocked off by a line of riot police. And then they decided to let us go. So they moved away. There was nothing violent. It wasn't like they decided to let us go through. They actually escorted us down Queen Street on their bikes. And again, we were chanting very peaceful things. It was nothing against the cops. It was just about the issues. So finally we got to Spadina and they blocked off Spadina. So we just kind of sat down. Some of them were singing O Canada. Very peaceful. We had peace signs up, and then a line of riot police starts circling over here. So I go up to one of the police. I go up to one of the police and I ask, is there any way we can get out? We don't want to be caught in this. How can we get out? They never once told us to leave. I've been hearing Chief Bill Blair say that they told us three times. Not once did one police officer say leave the premises, because if they did, I would have been gone.
It appears a group of peaceful protesters here on Spadina have offended the G20 leaders. They're upset at us for standing right here.
Yeah, we're just a bunch of people here peacefully protesting. I don't think, especially today, I've been here for a while, there's been nothing violent at all.
These cops keep telling us which way to go.
Yeah, we're kind of
violating our rights.
We're surrounded right now. There's a bunch of cops there telling us to go this way. A bunch of cops there telling us to go this way. A bunch of cops there blocking off that way. I don't know where to go.
Now they're actually cornering them in. I don't know if you can see, okay, I'm gonna zoom in. So there's cops in a line straight across the top of Spadina. They're cut off along Queen Street, they're cut off along Spadina, and Queen Street East, they're cut off there. You can see the riot cops. So they have nowhere to disperse to. Just for the record,
a line across, but I'm there now. They are just blocked.
No, that's what I'm saying. They're completely blocked in. So this is an overwhelming show of force. Look how many cops there are marching in now for the amount of protesters. There's even more. This is Queen Street.
So
the next army here. Okay, army here. Look how many guys are here. Even more, like, and this is on top of all these guys and all those guys. No, you can't see them coming out of Queen yet, but they're coming, man. They're fucking coming.
We are surrounded. Nobody threw anything today. No one threw anything today. So why are you provoking us? Why are you provoking us? Just tell us where to go. You're saying back, they're telling us to come here. So where do we go? They just told us to come here.
They're singing O Canada. So those riot cops actually just prevented people from leaving.
Oh, because they want to go north.
No, they want to fucking be able to hit them and shit. It's just a fucking disgrace. Not a single protester has done anything violent. I'm fucking shaking. I can't hold the camera.
People who don't know much about Toronto to know that the elite of Toronto belong to a club called the Empire Club, and so it's only fitting that they would have a security design like a this is the threat right now. Everyone's gonna be arrested if they don't leave, yet there is no exit. They want us to move, but there is no exit.
I think so. Yeah, you guys just asked me, can I go through? It's one letter, so what's the point?
What are they doing to these people? What are they doing to these 30 people, 40, 50 people? Where do they want them to move to? Where do they want them to move to?
They're absolutely not giving the protesters a way out, and they're hitting the protesters. He hit them with his shield. And it wasn't a defensive, it was a...
Peaceful! Who's the one armored with weapons?
For your safety, go home!
And they're going to cuff everybody that's in that group. And then I believe they're going to work their way up there.
Oh, yeah, they're pulling them out.
Yeah, and then I believe they're going to cuff all these fucking people. But there are definitely guys here. And there are these plainclothes officers with green armbands. That guy in a purple shirt's wearing one. It's reflective. Right there, walking down the center. And the guy next to him has a reflective armband. Yeah, those guys I was telling you about with the green armband are just swiping everybody right now, and they were targeting certain people. They didn't let anyone leave, eh? They came in here 45 minutes ago and had already blocked off the end of the road. All exits. That's insane.
And this was around 6:30 when I got put in the paddy wagon. Then one cop, we were there for about 2 hours. It was raining, it started to rain before we actually got inside. So by the time we were in, our clothes were soaking wet and they had cranked up the air condition in the vehicle. So we were freezing. They wouldn't allow us to go to the washroom. They wouldn't allow us to, there's one woman who started hyperventilating and they wouldn't allow her to leave. She was like, there's like holes in the door. So she was trying to breathe through there. Then I got moved to another one because one police officer said that's overcrowded. You can't do that. Then I got to move to another one, which had the same amount of people in it. 10 women to one 2 meter by 1 meter, like steel cage pretty much. And there was one lady there who was 50, she was 59 and she had a kidney condition where she only had a certain percentage of her kidney working. And she told the cops, can I please go to the washroom? If I don't go to the washroom, my kidney will burst. And they said no. So there was two women and they ended up having to pee themselves or pee on the floor of the paddy wagon. So we were stuck there for like 3 hours with the smell of urine, freezing cold. We asked them if we could just step out for some air because there were so many women, and they would shut the door so it was completely dark. I mean, you couldn't see your hand in front of, and you're just trying to huddle with the woman beside you. It was a desperate situation, and the cops were just joking around, making funny remarks at us. It was dehumanizing completely.
Go back now to Sammy Katz. He's our special correspondent inside this human box that's detaining but not really detaining him right now. Sammy, what's the latest?
The latest is that it looks like Disneyland right now, except like a very black version of Disneyland. People are lining up, waiting to be arrested in the pouring rain. They're boxing people in every morning. People just want to go home. So at this point, they're just putting their hands in the air and waiting their turn. The problem is that the riot police don't have the capacity right now to take everybody away. There's probably something like 200 people that I can see that are arrested. They don't have the capacity to arrest everybody else that's here right now.
Look at that rain. This is all part of the story right now. The heavy downpour. These people are being detained at Queen and Spadina in the pouring rain. They're soaking wet. They're cold. They're chilled. There's even pets in that area where they're being held.
You know, if there's anything you guys can do, if you can keep contacting the mayor for people here. I'm not the only one. I'm standing next to people who are just walking by, just taking pictures, just trying to see what's going on. They already took the protesters away. They took them out of the crowd about an hour and a half ago. And now this is just people, somebody was walking their dog, another couple was going out for dinner. You know, I was just taking pictures. A lot of people were just walking by, and now we're stuck in the rain for the past 2 hours, freezing cold.
Well, the public sentiment on this, it's not good, I can tell you that. And we need to hear from the police chief, the mayor, someone who can speak to this situation that seems absurd when I'm looking at a woman in a tank top standing in the pouring rain with her arms held behind her back, threat or no threat, processing this way seems very, very strange.
Now, in terms of, you were mentioning, Stephanie, the number of people that were not commenting. Well, I did have one police officer who spoke to me just off the record, and I said, hey, what's going on right now? And he says, the wagons are coming. And I said, well, what about the people? What's going to happen to them? And he said, if they're in custody, they're going in a wagon. And those are his exact words.
They're in the plastic handcuffs. They are being moved into the bus and shipped to the detention center, or at least the processing center, down on Eastern Avenue. There are still about 150 to 200 people just standing in the pouring rain, corralled by the riot squad, for no reason, no handcuffs, just standing there, not being given any water, not allowed to take bathroom breaks, not being told anything, not being given any explanation, not being asked any questions, just simply being held in a downpour. And you can see them shivering in the pouring rain. It is cold out right now.
We were just like go by police, but they've chartered buses and there's hundreds of people on these TTC buses. They've let us go. I can barely feel my legs. I'm still soaking wet. It looks like they've been severely embarrassed in this situation. They have six TTC chartered buses full of protesters, and they're taking them to the detention center now. It looks like they didn't have the capacity to take all of us, and they've let a lot of us go. Everybody's cheering. Everybody wants to go home. Everybody's soaking wet, and they just want to get out of here.
What do you want to say to Police Chief Bill Blair about this?
That was ridiculous. It was the worst. I don't feel safe around police anymore.
And so they finally, I guess they really couldn't take us anywhere because they had no space. They were trying to, we hear them on the phone trying to like see if they could take us to 32 Division or the Eastern Avenue is completely full, and they had no space to no spot to take us. So they ended up letting us out around 10:30 at night, right where we were detained, sat in the back of the paddy wagon for 4 hours for absolutely nothing. It was a complete power trip on so many levels. Like they were able to say and do anything to us. And knowing that we had no, absolutely no power. So, yeah.
Why is the G20 important? Well, the 20 finance heads of the industrialized world then come in. $1.2 billion is being spent in Canada. It's a total police state. Laws are passed so citizens have no due process and can be arrested. People are grabbed. There's secret police on trains, spying on everyone. People are just taken away for no reason. That's the headline. Secret law passed allows unlimited arrest. And then, magically, the anarchists show up. The police stand back, as is in these new videos, let them set police cars on fire that are parked there, and then let the media see it, and then they pull back and are left alone. And they've been caught in Canada hiring provocateurs to attack police so they can beat the hell out of Canadians. I mean, Canadians have an evil government, and they need to wake up to it.
I really do wish you were joking, but you're not. It is absolutely correct, everything you've just said. It is a repeat of Nazi Germany, except now they have a million times more powerful technology to treat us all like sheep.
Well, look at how their TSA kill people all the time. Just beat them to death. You can't speak English, and you're begging for help after 20-something hours in the terminal. They just beat you to death. Go ahead.
Alex, I just hope that you have advance warning when the actual roundups begin, because I don't think we're actually that far off from what I can see.
And the media does two things. They go and point cameras at police and government provocateurs to demonize all the protesters and say, oh, look at these anarchists who are engaged in violence, as a way to cause a chilling effect against all demonstrations. And it's working well. But they also point their cameras always at foundation-funded communists and say, oh, it's communist against capitalism protesting the banks. The big central banks promote communism for the general public's wealth, which then goes offshore to them. They promote collectivism at the lower level. And this is not capitalism having central banks stealing trillions of dollars from us, but this is all part of the semantical deception where the lies are just in the basic terms and the rules of the political game we're given are lies.
Yeah, it seems to be a big turning point, but I guess all these events are big turning points. But we need to speak out to the good people who might be working alongside the G20 puppet masters or in the police. Why are the good people not speaking out? What are they scared of? Why are they under this control?
Well, they feel like they're the winners. They feel like they're on the winning team. And even if they lean towards liberty a little bit, they still think it's safer to sit on the sideline. No, things are too dark. Things are getting too serious, folks. We're entering a very dangerous time. All of you need to do whatever you can, whether it's getting information out. If you're a police officer, you know about a unit of police that was assigned to help these private contractor anarchists come in. Just like they used an anarchist to start World War I or an anarchist to bomb Wall Street. That was the bankers doing that. An anarchist is just an agent of chaos so the system can come in. I don't mean an anarchist in its true sense. I mean these people calling themselves anarchists are normally just communist youth brigade people brought in by foundations.
Absolutely, Alex. I like to call myself a philosophical anarchist. I believe in the true ideals of anarchism against big government. But these Black Bloc children, most of them were very young. They were just there, oh, we're here to commit crime. We're here to just smash things up. They're just idiots.
That's why you don't see big people, you know, big crowds out demonstrating. It's simple. You go out and demonstrate now. And especially against the globalist or the World Trade Organization or anything New World Order, they just hire thugs to come burn a police car, and then they retreat and the police attack you. And they put it on the news that you did it.
Yeah, I'd just like to just touch upon that as well, Alex. I'm just so proud of the Toronto residents and the other associated protesters for the incredible restraint they showed amidst such police thuggery. The New World Order, they want a violent response from the public right now to further speed up their imposition of this technotronic advanced slave society. I believe right now, as what you're doing, Alex, is what Dan is doing, is what I'm doing right now. We just need to unlock people's minds, wake them up.
So it's all about theater of the mind, what Charlie Veach was just saying about selling you that you're going to be snatched, you're going to be grabbed. Don't come out to these. Don't mess with the bankers. This is an exercise in warring against us. We're the legitimate people saying we don't want to be raped by the foreign banks. We don't want to go into serfdom like Greece or Iceland. And they're saying, no, you're going to feel our full might. And so they are testing, and they admit this at each of these events, how to bring in their internationalization of a city, how to have secret police, how to have their criminal operation dominate everyone. This is about the city and your state your region, your country, going under globalist control. And they are under globalist control in these events. This is about your city going under foreign private corporate control. And now they're openly saying, yes, we're going to track you. Yes, we're going to spy on you. Yes, we're going to shut you down. Yes, we want to arrest people that tell conspiracy theories. I mean, what do they think is going to happen when they start trying to arrest people for their speech? Everybody's been fighting as hard as they can to keep this peaceful. But I don't think they realize we're not the poor, disarmed Russian peasants. We're not the disarmed Germans. And not everybody is a pot-bellied, decadent slob. I mean, I don't think all these little kids in black uniforms realize that they are really starting something that isn't going to end well. You notice as soon as they started selling derivatives in 99, they started setting up a police state. Because the IMF and World Bank have done this in countless third world countries. They've done this over and over and over again. They know what they're doing. And they know you're going to end up rioting. So I don't want violence, just like these anarchists gave this system a pretext to crack down. We want to peacefully go out and get the moral high ground and point out to the general public who the real criminals are. But down the road, they start trying to arrest political dissidents and take us to death dungeons, it's going to be like Robin Hood all over again. People aren't going to have a choice, and you will start seeing black arrows flying. And that's what happens when the badge and the government becomes a complete tyranny. I'm fighting to avert this as hard as I can. But as JFK said, those that make peaceful revolutions impossible make violent revolutions inevitable. Yeah, you're not in Kansas anymore. Neither am I. This is bona fide, real tyranny. And a lot of people say, well, I don't care if we live under tyranny. I go along. I got my job. I go along with what the government says. I submit to checkpoints and corruption and naked body scanners at the airports and the taxes always going up. I'm going to bend over. Well, they know you are. And that's why they're going to hurt you real bad. As Thomas Jefferson said, and as history shows, the level of tyranny you will live under is the exact level you'll put up with. They will not stop. The type of individuals in power worldwide throughout history are the types that always want more power. Listen, people say that cops can do no wrong in America. The media told us so. But did the Russian cops under Stalin and Lenin before him, were they bad? Were Hitler's police, the Gestapo, were they bad? Are Pol Pot's troops, were they bad? Was Pol Pot's police, were they oppressive? What about Fidel Castro? What about Mao Zedong? What about Julius Caesar? What about Attila the Hun? Oh, he had enforcers. So I'm here trying to keep our police from being turned into that historically. Why did our founding fathers fight the Redcoats? They became oppressive police. Have you read the Declaration of Independence? Read what the government was doing then and ask yourself, is that what's starting to happen now? I talk to so many people who have means, who are intelligent, who are informed, and they'll go, okay, so what if sodium fluoride's poison? So what if GMO food's bad? Yeah, there's a world government. But still, the media says you're a kook if you're against that. I don't want to look like a kook. So you're going to lose everything. Lose the dollar, lose your sovereignty, lose your children's future. You're going to go along with all this because you want to look like you're a mainline person. Is it mainline to jump off a cliff? Is it mainline to go along with Hitler? I guess it is. That's why it was mainline to have human sacrifice every day in the Aztec kingdom 1,000 years ago. It's totally insane, anti-human, satanic, but it's mainstream, so why not? When in Rome, do as the Romans did. You don't even control your own destiny when you just, like flotsam and jetsam, just get thrown around in the waves, whichever way the wind blows you. You're only alive once. Be part of standing up for humanity. It shows how brainwashed these people are that so many of these yuppies now will admit everything we're talking about is true, but say, what are you going to do about it? They have no respect for themselves. Well, it doesn't matter if they want to be slaves. Those of you out there that do hear the calling, that have looked into this information, that know it's true, it's your job to stand up against this evil and take action. And it's a great honor to be part of this. You're only alive once. We're alive at such an important time. Every generation has gone through critical crossroads, but this is the most critical in our history. The very survival of our species is at stake. Ladies and gentlemen, when they get rid of the Bill of Rights and Constitution, when they get rid of the Declaration of Independence, that's the shield for all of you. That protects all of us. They want tyranny so they can take all your pension funds. They want tyranny so they can conscript your children to be imperial stormtroopers in a global army to have their arms and legs blown off. They want tyranny so they can secure all their ill-gotten gains. Tyranny will target every one of you out there listening. And all of you good old boys and yuppies and people who think you're part of the establishment, you better count the cost right now and decide which side you're on, liberty or tyranny. You better decide whether you're going to get off the bench and be part of the second American Revolution against tyranny to restore the Republic, or whether you're going to sit there and suck your thumb and let all of this come to fruition. We need intelligent, able-bodied men and women who understand what's going on, doctors, lawyers, scientists, others, police officers, to stand up and be heard now, now, now. Now is the time.
It has now been 11 days of peace since my ordeal that I was subjected to by the Toronto Police Department in connection with my free speech at the G20 summit protests. I would like to state categorically that I was held as a political prisoner by a severe system which cared not for jesting or jokes, but was interested only in the vindictive and vengeful stripping of personal freedom in an attempt to discourage dissent and suppress criticism, sentient criticism of a machine that is long overdue to evolve. I firstly want to thank all the supporters who showed great community spirit in making it known that I was kidnapped twice, and for all your messages of support and donations which keep this dream alive and kicking. I also want to say that I'm amazed at all the well wishes of the Canadian people who have written to me by the hundred apologizing for the behavior of their law enforcement. To them I say, do not apologize, this is not a Canadian problem, but an international issue of whichever nation has become the bitch of the global elites and the whore of the IMF and World Bank in our brutally globalized world. Alas, thank you. I had no idea of the reaction of the outside world once I was incarcerated. I bow down before you all in gratitude, in humble thanks. I would also like to thank the Toronto Police Department and whoever gives them their orders for their great contribution they've given to the global philosophical awakening. By exposing your hand in the cosmic poker match, you show that you do not serve and protect, but rather control and suppress. We saw your agent provocateurs smashing the city. We witnessed your urban civilian roundup drills and mass internments. I felt firsthand the boot of tyranny upon my face as I was given a 2-day prison sentence without committing any crime. I, briefly, for 48 hours, experienced what it is like to be in a mass prison warehouse. I endured the psychological torture and humiliation. I patiently awaited my release from your hell, meditating on the joys of liberty and the far worse fate endured by political prisoners all around the world whose sentences are measured not in days, but in years. Thank you, Toronto Police, for lashing out and showing where you are in need of dramatic change. Thank you for bringing the true horror of your machine to the mainstream. Thank you for accelerating change by acting like the pathetic and scared bully that you are. Your contribution will not be forgotten. You have shown me the horror of loss of liberty, and you've cemented my commitment to the evolution and revolution of mankind. The Love Police is stronger and more robust after the lessons learnt at the G20 Toronto events. Once again, thank you. Rather than a group of savages as portrayed in the media, I met only peaceful and humanitarian-minded souls at the G20 protests. I learned that I have so much in common with Canadians, as we are brothers and sisters calmly trying to reason with the liars and murderers with machine hearts and machine minds. The solidarity I felt with you all as we stood our ground to the stormtroopers with the rubber bullet shotguns pointed at us is a feeling I will never forget. We got through to some of the militarized police, many of whom smiled eagerly at us, many more who hung their heads in shame at the orders they were not brave enough to disobey. We send a message of forgiveness and remind you that redemption is a trait most respected in humanity, and that today is the day you can turn your life around. You are not a badge. You are not a gun. You are not a robot. You are a human being being used to control and hurt your human family here on Earth. Do not stand for it. I am one man, but I am also the tens of thousands who supported me, who stand by me, and the countless and faceless amazing people who send their warmth. I have nothing to hide and do not want to run and be a fugitive. I live in the world of human beings, and I trust that in my heart that common sense will prevail, and that we can teach the Toronto Police a lesson in civility. There is no opposition, but rather disappointment at my treatment. Free speech is a foundation of all liberty, for it follows that those who wish to control what we say will attempt to control what we think. We can never let this happen, for our forefathers did not fight and sacrifice their lives in order for the very fascism we opposed to be implemented at home. It should never have come this far, but as they say, if you're going through hell, keep going. There is no surrender. There is no taming of the wild inherent in colonized minds returning to independent thinking. Liberty is timeless, and the time for freedom is yesterday, tomorrow, today. With much love and thanks, Charlie Veach, Love Police Undercover Detective.